going to do is take you through each major portion of the lab handout. So the lab handout is four portions or four parts, whatever you want to call it. The objective, first where I introduce the subject and the purpose of the lab, and then we go into the procedure, and then data collection, and then data analysis, basically, or applied exercises, kind of same thing. So first we're going to start off with an objective. I try to keep it short in these videos just because, you know, I don't want to sit here and go through an entire lecture again, and I know you don't either. So if you do find that you need more explanation on colligative properties in general or any subject that you see here in these lab pre-lab videos, please visit like the lecture videos, the lecture material videos. In these, I kind of just go through it pretty quickly and concisely. So in this lab, we are applying our knowledge of colligative properties. Colligative properties of a solution are those properties that depend on the number of solute particles. So they do not depend as they normally would for other types of properties. They do not depend on the identity. They depend on how many, so the amount or number of whatever particles you have. So it doesn't matter what type of particles they are, it doesn't matter the identity. It matters how many you have. And these four properties that are affected by how many particles you have or how much solute you have is vapor pressure lowering, boiling point elevation, freezing point depression, and osmotic pressure. So we can actually measure the freezing point of both a solvent and a solution, and we can determine the difference. So difference, I know it sounds kind of strange, the depression and elevation. Both of these just mean a difference, right? And both of these just happen to go different ways. So for freezing point, between a solvent and a solution, you're going to see the solution have a lower, right? You see how it's lower? Boiling point. This is our temperature. For boiling point, you will see an elevation. So here, what we're seeing is freezing. And before I kind of talk more, let me go ahead and clarify the axes. So this is time. So as time goes on, you will see that freezing occurs, right? Liquid is freezing as time goes on. This over here on the y-axis, so that's the x-axis time. On the y-axis, we see temperature. So as the temperature is increasing, you can see how things are changing. So like I said, freezing point happens to be that it decreases between a pure solvent and a solution. So we see here that the freezing point of the solvent is what, up here? And we don't really have, this is just like a diagram to show you the difference. There's not really a number, right? It's arbitrary assigned to it. So we see that it's higher up here. And then for the solution, we see that it's lower right here. So there's a difference. And this difference right there, that delta, anytime you see a delta, so a delta is that triangle in Greek letter, that means change or difference. So again, depression means difference here. And it just happens to always mean, it means that your solution is always going to be lower. So how do we see our freezing point here? So we can see that these lines, they don't exactly go, you know, straight the way that this dotted line is going. So how are we determining this freezing? How are we determining that it is right here? If we see that the line, this line of data doesn't really match up. We're going to talk about that right now. But I just wanted to give you the overall idea. In the lab handout, I point out what each of these lines, these colorful lines and boxes mean. So you can go ahead and read that if you want. But overall, and I know all I've talked about so far is freezing point depression, right? Overall, the purpose is to find the molar mass. And we're going to talk about that right now, too. Okay, so now we're going to get into how exactly we're going to calculate the molar mass. So I'm going to take you through this little flowchart that kind of outlines this for you. So the difference in freezing points can be calculated using this equation, right? But that's only if you have your molality and your KF. Your KF is your freezing constant. That is specific for any of your types of solutions or solvents. So if you have this information, then you can calculate your delta TF. But there's another way you can calculate your delta TF using like actual data and a line, right? So a line graph where you plot your temperatures over the reaction time. So here we can see that we can calculate this difference. Now, how do we calculate this difference? Wherever you start to see, so what's going to happen whenever solutions or solvents freeze is that you're going to have a dip in temperature, right, as you decrease the temperature. And then you're going to have a little dip. After this little dip, you're going to have a plateau. So for this pure solvent, you actually see this plateau really nice and straight. That plateau is your freezing point. That's why, you know, the calculation, that's your end point for your pure solvent. That's your freezing point for your pure solvent. And then for your solution, it'll be a little bit wonky, right? It's not going to be perfect and completely match up to this plateau. But wherever it dips and then goes back up, sorry, I can't talk. wherever it dips and goes back up, that's what we consider our plateau. So that's why it was outlined right there. And I know this is getting kind of messy, but hopefully you get the point. And you can see it more clearly on just the diagram by itself. So that's where we are getting our delta T, right? Instead of having the molality and having the KF right away given to us, we are going to actually measure this delta TF out, our difference in freezing points. So once you get that delta TF, right? So we were given this. We're going to be given this, our freezing point of solution and solvent, okay? You are going to figure out the delta TF by looking at the data and finding that difference. And then from there, what we're going to do, and this is this step right here. This is what I'm about to show you. So because we have our delta TF, we will be able to solve for our molality. How? Because I'm also going to give you this value right here, the KF. So what we're solving for right now is molality. Oops. So I'm going to divide both sides by KF. Now, this gives me molality equals delta TF divided by our freezing constant. So that's where I'm at now. We're at our molality. After that, you are going to calculate the moles of your compound in your sample and then the molar mass. And I'm going to take you through those steps, but overall, this is the general idea that we are using this equation and the data that we gather from the graphs in order to eventually first get the molality, and then, you know, after these steps over here, we will end up getting the molar mass. So in this lab, we'll be determining the freezing point of a solvent and then a solution. And then using that information, you will find the molar mass of the solute. So I already kind of gave you a preview of what you're doing, but first I want you to do some just general research into T-butyl alcohol, which is, if we were in the lab, we would be working with T-butyl alcohol and making a solution, you know. Obviously, we can't do that now, but I still want you to at least get the hang of that, just in case, you know, you go back to take organic chemistry, if you're taking it, and then they're going to make you do something like this. So at least you get the hang of that, and you kind of have an idea of what MSDS is, and then how you have to search up certain properties and characteristics of certain chemicals, solutions, solvents. So we're going to report that information in Table 1. Very simple. Step 2, we will approximate the freezing point for each graph. And remember, I was talking about the little plateau. That's what you're going to be doing here. So the way you approximate the freezing point is you have to look at the small plateau after the dip in the curve. Okay, you're going to determine to 2 decimal places, take the average of both trials, report values in Table 2, because there's 2 trials for each, both the solvent and the solution. So overall, there's 4 graphs that you're going to be looking at. There's a table for that, Table 2. And then in that using information from Table 2, we are also going to apply that and do basically our data analysis And from there, you will be doing a bunch of calculations, which I don't have listed out just here just yet, but I do have it listed out on the lab handout. And that will be reported in Table 3. Okay, so these are the four trials that I was, not four trials, two trials, but one is for the solvent. So T-butyl alcohol is your solvent by itself. This is for your solution right here. So these two right here are for your solution. I abbreviate solution, S-O-L-N, period. Remember, chemists are lazy. So, as you can see here, these are not as pretty as, you know, this little general graph diagram. They're not as clear. And that's okay, that's how real life data is. It's not pretty the way that it is in textbooks. But you're basically gonna follow your instinct wherever you see a dip. So for example, here's a dip right there, and I don't want to give it away, so I'm not going to exactly give you the line, but I'm just showing you, for example, where some dips are. So dip right there, there's a little dip right there, and I think that's enough. So yeah, find the dips, then, you know, from there. So I'll give you one. There's a little dip right here, right? And then there's a little plateau. So I would go ahead and do this if I were you guys. Well, obviously it's straighter, you know, that's kind of ugly. And just try your best to approximate it to do two decimal places. And then after, you are going to, you're going to report that data in Table 2, the data coming from the graphs. Next, you are going to have to calculate a bunch of stuff. Now, in order for you to receive credit for all of this, you have to show your work, right? So there's two ways that you can show your work. You can either, you know, if you are that person and who has access to a printer and that's what you like doing, you can print out the lab, you can do the work on the, you know, the lab itself, because there's some like free space on the last page. And then you can, you know, make sure you box everything, report everything in the tables, and then scan that and upload that. Or if you don't have access to a printer, that's completely okay. What you can do is do the work on a piece of paper, scan it or take a picture of it, and then insert it. You know, you're gonna have to obviously email the picture or upload it somehow to your computer, and then get it onto your Word doc, and then just have it there to show that you did the work by hand. You can also do it by typing, but it's just harder, like for me to read, it's just difficult. Honestly, I think it just looks easier for you to like write it out and then just insert a picture. So be aware that you need to do one of those two options, either take a picture or just scan the work with it, or you can also upload the work as a separate file. It's easier if you do everything in one PDF, honestly, or if you do everything in one Word doc. I'm just letting you know right now, it's easier for me to grade. It's easier for you to upload because it's all one thing. But as long as you attach some sort of work or the work is somehow included, then you're good. So these are the steps that you're going to be taking. If you take it step by step in the order that I gave you, you should be able to solve it. And I'm actually going to go through an example where we basically do the same thing. So you can use that also in order to help you. Okay, so in the objective part of your lab handout, you hopefully should have seen that I tell you about an example that you can look at. So this example from your book is example 11.11. It is from section 11.4, and I put the link here. And I know you can't access the link right here, but if you open up the PowerPoint that I uploaded, which is the PowerPoint that I just went through in this video, you can see this problem. So however you want to access it, but it's example 11.11. I'm going to go through this exact one so that we all are on the same page. You know, you can access it through the book or you can just look at it here. It's up to you. And that's where I got this little figure from. So we have a solution of 4 grams of a non-electrolyte dissolved in 55.0 grams of benzene. It's found to freeze at 2.32 degrees C. Assuming ideal solution behavior, what is the molar mass of this compound? So in this problem, we are essentially doing the same type of problem we have for the slab. Okay, the only thing that we're not doing is collecting freezing point data from graphs. Here it's given to you, right? Freezing point of this, of the pure benzene is that, and then the freezing point of your solution is that. So here, you're given those knowns. In the lab, you have to find those knowns, but it's okay, you know, it's just coming from the graphs. That's all you have to do is get it from the graphs. So here we have the freezing point. So I'm gonna write little f, freezing point of solution, or TF, that's probably better, yeah. It matches the other stuff. So TF of solution is 2.32. Sorry, that's horrible. And then we also have TF of solvent, 5.5 degrees C. What other information do we have? We have a solution of 4 grams dissolved in 55 grams of benzene. So we dissolve 4 grams. And then we have a solvent, mass of solvent. Sorry, I should have written mass. Mass of solvent, mass of solute. So mass of solvent, 55 grams. So now we have all our knowns. Now let's figure out our unknown. Our unknown, and if you follow this chart, that's not this chart, this flow chart. That's the whole point of me having it here, is to kind of get you situated, and then eventually you should be able to kind of just have a better idea and it should flow more easily without, you know, needing this. But either way, you can have it with you. So our unknown first is our first unknown is our delta TF, right? We have our freezing point of our solution. It's right here. We just wrote it out. We're actually going to use that along with our freezing point of our solvent, and we're going to calculate our delta TF. So our first unknown is delta TF, and then from there we will be able to calculate our molality. So our delta TF is our difference. So we should always see that our solution freezing point is lower. So we're going to take 5.5 degrees C, subtract 2.32, and we end up getting 3.2. So we found our delta TF. Now from here, we are going to determine our molality. So if you remember, we have another equation that's actually also consider it a known, is molality times our KF. KF is our freezing constant. Our freezing constant for this solution, and I actually just realized it's not given right off the bat in this problem. You have to go look for it on a table, and I know you're probably like, oh, am I gonna have to do that for the exam? No, I meant to put it right after this freezing point. I actually added this freezing point in because it doesn't give it to you in the problem directly. I meant to put it here. That's completely my bad. It's from table 11.2. But basically, the freezing point constant, KF, for benzene is 5.12 over molality. So I should have given that to you in the problem, but either way, you can find it in table 11.2. But anyway, here it is now. So we have this, right? Our delta TF right here. And we also have this, so we can solve for our molality. So let's go ahead and do that. And like we did earlier, we are going to divide both sides by KF in order to isolate our molality. So now molality is our delta TF divided by KF. So I'm going to fill that in. So delta TF is 3.2 degrees C divided by 5.12 degrees C over molality. And you should end up getting 0.63. And because this molality is the denominator of a denominator, ends up like flipping around, That's like a kind of a math trick, but it ends up just being molality. So now we have 0.63 molality. So now we have our molality, and you're probably like, okay, what do we do next? So let's see what we've done so far. We had the freezing point of the solution. We calculated our delta TF, both those steps. We calculated our molality. That's where we're at right now. Our next step is to calculate moles of the compound in the sample. How are we going to do that? So the thing with molality, the thing with molarity, both of these, you can apply the same concept, is that these are not singular units. They're actually kind of like derived units, meaning that they come from more than one type of base unit. So here, molality, what it actually means and how you actually calculate it, is moles over kilograms of solvent, specifically moles of solute, okay? And you know, I'm kind of getting into the definitions of these concentrations, but this is just like a short review on that and how you can use it as a conversion factor, because that's basically what we're doing here. So anytime you have something that's a molality, you can break it up like this. So I'm going to show you. This right here also equals 0.63 moles solute over 1 kilogram of solvent. Okay? Anytime you have a molality, you can break it up like that. So that's what we're going to do, and we are going to use it as a conversion factor in order to calculate moles. So if you notice, we have mass of solvent, and I had it on the previous slide, but this mass of solvent, specifically it's in grams of solvent, right? Grams and kilograms, those can be, you know, you can convert one to the other, and then we can make it match and cancel out, right? We're doing some dimensional analysis. So that's what we're going to do here. We're going to convert those 55 grams of solvent to kilograms first. So 10 to the third grams, you can do it either way. There's another way you can set up this prefix conversion, but you can do it this way if you want. So now we have our grams to kilograms. This cancels out, and basically what we're doing is dividing by 3. So we end up moving this 3 times. So not dividing by 3, we are dividing by 1,000. We're moving the decimal 3 times. So you should end up getting 0.055 kilograms. So now we have our kilograms of solvent, and now we can set up this in order to cancel out those kilograms and get moles. So I'm going to set up our 1 kilogram of solvent and then 0.63 mole. So we're going to multiply the 0.055 kilograms times 0.063. So kilogram solvent, I forgot to cancel that out. But that cancels out. Kilogram solvent cancels out over here, and then from here you end up getting 0.035 mole solute. So now we have mole. Hopefully you remember, a molar mass is mole, grams per mole. It obviously involves mole. It's grams always on top, and then divided by moles, divided by 1 mole specifically, whenever you have the number already. But in this case, we don't have the molar mass. So what we're going to do is we have the moles. We actually have the mass. And remember, I had it written out earlier. We had mass of solute. So we've got moles. Now we're going to find the molar mass. And all you have to do is take the 4 grams of solute and divide it by our moles, 0.035 mole. And that gives you grams over moles. And, you know, once you figure out the sig fix to it, which is basically 2, we should end up getting 1.1 times 10 to the 2. And that's, these are all the steps that you're essentially doing. Remember, the only difference that I discussed was the fact that in this problem you're given the freezing points of both the solution and the solvent, but in your lab you have to determine those freezing points and find the difference using the graph data. So just let me know if you have any questions, but if not, hopefully this video cleared some things up for you. And like I said, yeah, let me know if you have any questions.